Thank you for all people. Thank you very much. And now we will start the second masterclass in the framework of Apple project. It's Erasmus Plus project, and our university is one of participants in this project. The main goal of this project is is modernization of higher education in the field of robotics, intelligent systems, and space exploration. You know this, yes? Thank you. And now our colleagues from Belgium, from university, Thomas More University, will present masterclass.
Thank you.
Let's start. Please tell some information for our guys.
Yeah. Okay.
About good. Your university, about yourself.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Back in Maria. We are happy to be here. My name is Stan.
I'm Bert.
We are not into computers. We are not into IT. We are not into tech. But hopefully we can make like a great day for you and give you some ideas to think about, because we believe that even if you are a very good tech man or tech woman, that you do need some entrepreneurial skills, because you are young people, you have to change the future for Belarus, but for the world. And maybe we can support you in that by having this day together. It will be a special day.
Stan is founder of the Startup School in Belgium. I'm co-founder of the Belgian Advertising School. I have my own company too. And today, in we are going to steal 8 hours of your life. You will never get them back. But hopefully, at the end of the day, you have a $1 million business idea and a business opportunity plan. So this is in Belgium we say, this is a hackathon. Today, we want to introduce you to the following. I hope internet works. We want to introduce you to the startup mentality. So maybe a lot of you guys think, I'm just doing school, I'm going to work for a big company, and in 50 years' time, I'm going, it's okay for me, I did my work. But in my opinion, in 5 years' time, everybody should think like a freelancer, like having their own company. And that's what we will try to get you guys planted in.
And even if you're going to work in a big company, people over there need entrepreneurs in that company as well. You have to see the opportunity and you have to be able to change what's going on. So, who is an entrepreneur here? Somebody has his own company here? Okay, then maybe after today you have the idea for your own company. That's one of the objectives we have. But it's mainly the way these people are thinking that we would like to introduce to you. So before lunchtime you will need no computer, you will need your brains, open mind, some creativity, and think together. Basic ideas, what Geert is writing. We are going to look for opportunities. Where is your idea added value for society, for people, for companies, for organizations? And that's what we are looking for.
So some of you might get rich, but some of you also might make the world a better place with their $1 billion idea.
Geert, maybe we should tell something about Thomas More.
Yeah,
sure. I recognize some people who were in the master classes yesterday as well. So they get the whole picture of our colleague Dirk, who is in the back, working very hard. He gives the whole picture of Thomas More. We are a university in Belgium and in the region around Antwerp, big city, 1 million inhabitants. In Belgium, we are, I think our country
come
is...
Come in.
You're welcome. Belgium is about only the surface of only 1/8 of Belarus, but we are 11 million people, so it's quite dense. And our campuses are spread around 7 cities in this northern region, against the Dutch border, Holland. Right? Mm-hmm. So that's where we are living. We have study areas, different study areas, not only tech, but we have also social sciences, business, communications, nursing, teacher education. We have 14,000 students, undergraduate level. So our students, they are graduating with a bachelor degree. And as you have told me, we are both working over there. Me are working in the startup school. And Geert is working in communications department. That's the main thing. You're coming from Belgium, which is Geert, the country of?
Yeah. Two things are important in Belgium. Who remembers from yesterday?
Beer.
Yes, the first thing is this, beer. This is the Dutch for devil. If you drink this, you become a bit of a devil. This is for the winner. Who wins? At the end of the day, we will divide you in teams. You'll have form your own business plan, opportunities. At the end, you'll pitch, you'll present. In 5 minutes, you'll say, our million-dollar idea is the following. And we will be a jury and say, okay, you win, you get to take home the devil. And the other thing Belgium is famous for? Chocolate.
Great!
So we also have chocolate from Manneke Pis. I don't know if you know him. It's a famous statue. It's a guy peeing. That's Belgium for you. And the other thing Belgium is famous for are diamonds. So I brought some. No, we don't have any diamonds. But this is for the win. And hopefully a good idea.
Kicking off, this was the introduction.
Yeah.
So hope you have like a clear view. The rest of the day, it will be mainly up to you. We will try to give some inspiration and guide you through the day. The first aspect of inspiration is going to be given by Geert.
Yeah.
And afterwards, we will work. You have been seeing some paperwork outside. This will be the place where you have to work because this is too crowded. Working here is very difficult, you know, we are thinking, but we have lots of space outside, so.
There will be a post-it war, so you'll have to have your ideas on post-its and in the hallway, but what Stan says is really correct. It's up to you. Some of you will.
There's still some chairs open, you can use them maybe first, because.
Maybe if you slide to the back a bit, everyone.
And within 15, 20 minutes, we'll be outside.
Yeah.
Okay, ready for some inspiration. You know, the world is changing. Everybody is telling it. We and lots of people believe that it's a big opportunity. But it's difficult. You have to see these opportunities. Some people are scared to see these opportunities. I want to do so. But we, you as a young people, you have the responsibility to look for opportunities and to embrace this changing world. And you have the capacity, as you are very smart, and you have lots of tech knowledge in your backpack. So this to look for opportunities is not so easy, and that's why Geert is going to present you based upon you have had a document. We sent you a link beforehand where you could read this report, which is a leading agency on trend watching. We are taking out some examples just to think with you and to prepare your mindset for the brainstorm afterwards, okay? Mm-hmm. And Geert is picking out some examples to see what is possible, to see what opportunities are, and to help embracing this new, fast-changing world, okay?
Yeah, thank you. I've picked five important trends for 2017-2018. Trends which generate a lot of business ideas. These are the five trends you can find in the Fjord Trends Report. Ephemeral is a very difficult word, it's just short. Short video, mostly video stories. There's a lot of business in video these days. Homes without boundaries, it's smart homes. I don't know if you know augmented reality a bit, virtual reality, all the differences there, business opportunities. Any car buffs? Who has a car? Who has a car here? No one? Car? Someone? Tesla? World on wheels. A lot of the cool thing about the world on wheels is you don't have to drive anymore, but people will get bored. So there's a lot of business possible to entertain people while they get driven by a sort of smart car to work. So that might generate some ideas. And me, myself, and AI, artificial intelligence. Smart kids like you can code and make things better. These are my five trends, and I have some examples too. So the first one, short stories. Who of you has Snapchat on their phone? Snapchat? Only one? We should connect. Do you have, who has Instagram? Instagram? Okay. Do Do you make short stories? 5 seconds? Video? Not really.
Sometimes.
Who does that on Facebook? I think it's only one person in the world. Okay? They copied it. You can make short videos. That is one of the things about short stories. It's only been here for a year, 2 years. But the thing is, how can you make money with short stories? Where is business?
Advertise.
Advertising is a very good one. I work in advertising. You could partner up with famous brands and say, okay, let's do this with influencers, they say, and so on. But there's also money in the hardware of video. One of my favorite slogans is, be a hero. You know, from which brand? Be a hero. Is
GoPro.
GoPro. And even Spiegel, you know that guy? Said, we have Snapchat, but I want to make money with something else too, with hardware. Mm-hmm. You know what? Okay.
Sure.
A good startup mentality doesn't start crying when the movie doesn't work. But it's a shame. I have 5 movies for you. And picked them, worked on it for hours, and it doesn't play. But okay. Snapchat spectacles, in short, it's like that guy has. He has a sort of sunglasses, but it's with a sort of, if you tap it, it records what you see for how many seconds? Anyone? 10 seconds. And you can tap it a few times and it automatically connects with your smartphone and it puts it online. The cool thing, and that's in a movie fragment about Snapchat, is you don't have to use your hands anymore. So you can bike, you can ski, you can do all crazy stuff, and automatically it puts it online. You know how much it costs? It's $149, I guess. And the other cool thing about the marketing of Snapchat spectacles was you couldn't buy it. You had to go to a special pop-up store. Hey, where's the pop-up store? It's in Berlin now. 10 days later, it's in New York. And so there was a whole fuss about it, and they sold a lot of Snapchat spectacles. Maybe today one of your groups has a new sort of Snapchat spectacle. That is the first example. Second one, blurred reality. Anyone can explain the difference between virtual reality, augmented reality, mixed reality? You're the smart guys in the group. But who played Pokemon Go? I'm sorry, I played it too. The first time, sort of augmented reality, you just go, no, I told my wife, I'll go walk in the park with the kid, no problem. So, it's the first time a real business started for me worldwide. Normal people got to know augmented reality. That's a big business, and it's going to be a big business. Do you know any other examples? I have some cool examples in the clip that won't play. But do you have another idea about how could you make money with virtual augmented reality? I think in
hardware.
Okay. Hardware, software, whatever. If you have an idea, there are no bad ideas.
Google Glass, they just promote their solutions to factories or some.
Yeah? If you say something, you always get rewarded for your cojones. I don't know how your Spanish is, for your big boss. So there you go. The coolest thing ever. I just found it out preparing these classes in Dubai and in Japan. You now have a 7D zoo. And I'm pretty sure in 10 years' time, people look back at our zoos now and say, you're barbaric. All these animals in small cages, just put up your goggles and have the VR zoo. I'm going to try it anyway to show you the clip. It works in the beginning. Company Magic League. You know, probably. This is the 70 Zoo. It's just in a mall. There's nothing there. It's all projected holographs.
It's just a little touch of the shape of the ocean. It sure is safe the first time, but it's not right, it's so far.
Watch out! Get the idea, hopefully. 7D zoom, nothing there, but children are like, oh, what's this? Another thread. I have 5 threads for you guys. World on Wheels. The main idea, let me repeat that main idea. People are getting driven to work. I have to drive to work, it's 25 minutes. If the car is driving itself, I'm bored easily. I want to be entertained. There are a million entertainment companies possible to entertain people driving to work. Or maybe you have another idea. This is a granny, a grandmother, another film fragment, who is going nuts because the car is driving itself. Let's keep it Tron. You don't hear it that well, but she's cursing. She's, oh my God, Jesus Christ. The car is just, it's just a Tesla driving itself. That might give you some ideas. Coming closer to what you study, making things, coding, what you did yesterday with Derek. Smart homes. Smart homes are a big opportunity to make a living. Anyone here ever seen Amazon Echo or Nest? Domestic smart homes. This is the all new Echo Dot. Exists already. Let me give you, try and give you a short introduction. This is it. It connects with everything. So your windows go up, your curtains go up. Smart assistant. And the last one for you guys, AI. So I'm trying to plant some seeds in your head. That might say, okay, maybe this or maybe that. AI, the I don't know if you know the hype cycle. The thing about this is everyone, if I ask my mother, they say, oh, it doesn't work, 3D printing, it doesn't work, but it's the hype cycle. And it gets in the news, people say, ah, it's going to be great, and then it falls down because it's not there yet. But then if you wait a few more years, it gets it grows exponentially, it gets there. And that's also with Amazon and AI. 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, there was something happening with 2 robots, AI. Does anyone remember? They shut them down. There were 2 robots talking to each other. How are you? How are you? And what happened then?
They wanted to conquer something.
They became very rude and
rude and stuff happened, and at one moment they started to form their own language, and the people who made the computer, they couldn't react to the computer, so they just made their own language. So that was pretty scary. It was a bit of a Terminator vibe. I know that movie.
Terminator, are young people. Do you know the movie Terminator?
We're old. Reference. But that is interesting too. Elon Musk is one of the founder of Tesla and a lot of Solar City and all. He's very scared of what AI can do. But there are definitely some opportunities there. I don't know if any one of you saw the movie Her. It's a movie. What is it about?
It's about a assistant, a girl who helped a man to kind of fill his life with somebody else because he was alone, and I don't want to spoil, so it's like I am talking about.
Very good. We won't give you another lollipop because you'll have to go to the dentist. It's not that far away. In the previous example, we had Amazon Alexa. Alexa is like Siri on an iPhone, and you say something and they react, they do some things for you, you eat the oven or what you want, it works. The next step, and Dirk is working with someone who's thinking of avatars, if you make Siri or Alexa into a human, or a sort of hologram, and combining the trends we have, you sort of have a person, but it's a robot. And then the next phase of that is, if you have people who are lonely, can't find their partner, and that could be your solution. You have holographic wives. Let's not go any further in that way. But that is a big business too. And this is a very melodramatic, nice movie of what are the consequences emotionally. Dating, this is dating your computer. So that is some trend inspiration internationally. Okay. These, to end it up, Stan, these are the five trends. We think you can make, in 1 hour or more, you can make 100 companies. You can find your own ideas.
Maybe it's important to stress the fact that these are ideas. People have organized their startup, me, an entrepreneur, because they saw an opportunity. It's not all luxury. I mean, it looks like it's only for the happy few. But if you think through, there are lots of opportunities who are also having very large impact on society, on well-being of people. We have like, there is a student of ours who graduated, I think, 2 years ago, and she had an idea. It's called Fashion on Brainwaves. You can measure brainwaves, and it makes changing the color of your clothes based upon your humor, your
mood. If you're happy, it's happy. If you're
happy color, and okay, it seems like, oh, it's no use. It's interesting. It's nice. It's high tech, but now there is like an hospital mm-hmm. is involved, and they are investing it because they want to develop clothing when you get surgery, and then they can also see what is the situation of the patient. You have like the figures, your heartbeat, but you have also like what is he feeling,
and it can
save lives, fashion on brainwaves in the future. So what I mean is, look, opportunities can be, okay, you can get rich, but you can improve society, you can make our lives better.
A good Belgian example, of a startup is Zest or Nest or Zembro, or I don't know the name. But the idea is simple. You have to look at your market. When we walked here and had a drink or two or three last night, we were amazed by all these young people. If you go to Belgium, it's sort of the museum of the world. They're all old people. And the guys from the startup, I don't remember the name, they just developed a bracelet for old people. Because a lot of times when old people fall, they're like 2 days, no people around. And if they don't move for a couple of, an hour or two, or 30 minutes, I don't know what it is, you get a stress signal to your daughter or to your... And this is a very good idea. So you don't have to have all the Tesla examples today. Mm-hmm. The winner of this great devilish beer and co. will probably be someone who also understands, and that's the second part of today too, well, first to your brainstorm. This is the market, there are a lot of people needing this. It's also some value creation for the world. It's not only for me and the money.
These are some ideas. But now it will be up to you.
I'll show you.
Prepared for you these papers in the hallway. I have been counting, I think there are like 53 people in this room. So you will be in groups of at least 5 persons. There are 10 papers outside. This is for your brainstorm. You see on top of here are the 5 trends we mentioned, but also your passion, because that is the key element for an entrepreneur. You are not able to work all your life developing things if you're not passionate about it. So please, this is only inspiration. If you have a good idea outside this, no problem. We are going to help think about this idea and changing it into a business concept. In a minute, you are outside, you have to divide in groups, so just spread around and see if you are 5 people at each paper. You get some materials, of those papers, sticky notes, stick them, okay?
Yeah. Pens, markers,
and write down. There is no such thing as a bad idea in a brainstorm. Even if you think it's not useful when you write it, maybe your colleague can have an idea based upon your idea. This is the way it works.
Yeah.
The first 10 minutes, you are going to down everything you think about. Everybody should have written at least 10 to 15
post-its. So you write an idea on a post-it and you stick it up.
The paper can be filled.
Yeah.
On this paper you can use both post-its and the pencil directly. It's no problem. Later on you have to, it's compulsory to use the sticky notes. So write down. Use these first 10 minutes individually. You don't have to negotiate. Everything you think about is okay. It can be inspired by the 5 examples, or if you read the trend report, the other things in it is good. But it can be also based upon your private life, your passion,
hobbies.
Your hobbies you're doing, your study area, your boyfriend, your girlfriend,
your
family,
problems.
Things you discover. We had last year people working on beekeeping, because one of the students, he was a beekeeper, but he could not monitor his, the home of the bees in a good way. And they made an Internet of Things application with several modules to monitor. But his passion was beekeeping. That was the idea. So let it come. You use the first 10 minutes to write down everything. And then you can see, you can look at and read the ideas of your colleagues. If you don't understand something, ask each other, talk about.
Discuss, yeah.
Discuss it. After 45 minutes, you have like maybe 100 ideas on the paper. Only then you will be able to look for what is the best, what is the thing I want to work on today. We will not put them away, you get it. So if there are other good ideas on it, you can make your business out of it later on, no problem. Today we use one in the afternoon to present and to win chocolate and beer. So. Okay, first team, making groups, then 10 minutes of brainstorming individually, at least 10 ideas on paper,
yeah.
At least, but it maybe 50 as well. The more, the better.
Yeah. You can only start if you have a crazy team name. So think about it, you'll have to be in teams of 5 and you have to have a crazy team name. Okay?
Is this clear to start a brainstorm? Because later on you are outside, it's more difficult to coach you as a whole group. We will be there. We will be walking around helping you out.
If you're with 5, you can come over and get post-it notes and some pens. If you're with a team of 5, come over.
Okay, let's
and
start.
One outside.
Half past 10. Brainstorm is over. We will have a 10-minute break then. Everything on it, where you think about it, the idea will follow afterwards. We will help you. So, it's very important that there are a lot of words in it. It's very important, even if they are meaningless for you. Go, go. It's good. Associations. It doesn't have to be the perfect idea. I saw kids having fun in a spare time. It was in a shopping mall. People, I don't know. You saw water, but apparently you can't feel. Thank you. It's a mindset. It's very difficult to put in something on a paper when you don't know where it gets you afterwards. And we've been seeing it and going around. It was also very also on an individual basis to put 10 ideas on a paper. It should trigger you. But now the second step is also a difficult one because you did a good job and you had plenty of ideas and associations on this paper. And now you have to connect things and look for the one thing that attracts you, or you see the most opportunity in it, or you combine, like maybe gaming, which is your hobby, you do a lot of gaming, and combine it with sitting on a terrace and maybe something you saw in the hospital last week. I don't know. So, and then this idea, we are going to work on it in to convert it into a business concept. That's for after the break. You have one big job to do before we can continue at 11 o'clock, and that's speaking out. We know it's a short time. We are not going to set up a startup in one day, but you have to feel what things you need to do to be an entrepreneur. So you have these plenty of ideas on this paper now. You, again, on an individual basis, you can pick out like your top idea or the thing you want to work on. That's my thing. Probably, and I've heard in discussions, you've already had some negotiations. I think that's good and we can combine it with that. In some of the groups, it works already towards like a concept. Some of you really need to discuss on, about what is on the paper right now. After the break, at 11 o'clock, we will continue and I will explain you how you can translate it in an easy way to a business concept. That's the next step. So you have your paper now. We are breaking up, but you need to do a little work. Some of you already did the work. You picked out this one idea. You can wait for the next step after the break. Some of you have to pick, combine things, see what is the thing you want to work on. You can ask Kate and me to help picking, to help choosing based upon what is on your paper. If you already have your ideas, okay, then we can continue at 11 o'clock. If not, we will help you. It's no problem.
Okay. So at 11, you have one business idea. And then we'll make a business plan out of your idea.
Yeah.
And in the afternoon, we'll present. I'll train you how to present your idea, how you can convince an investor like us to give you money to build your idea.
Money.
Okay? So it's quite a big break. I have my best ideas, not in this hallway, not in front of a computer. I have my best ideas outside, mostly when I jog and I listen to my monotonous heartbeat, and then the sort of ideas come in like a flow of ideas. So if you want to go out, sit out, take some sun in, all fine, but at 11 o'clock each team has a crazy name and a crazy business idea. Okay? Let's wrap it up. See you at 11 here. Good luck.
В принципе,
не сказать особо нечего.
Ну, просто мне
типа.
Сразу сюда понятно. Это Алтафренс, знаешь, все традиции, как во всех странах.
Кого?
Я думала, что будет такое, ну, типа, прикольно.
Есть не VR, есть что-то.
Вот как тогда еще.
А мы будем. Синхронизация по
какую-нибудь суперсилу свою. Такой другого, и у него такой типа.
Огненный шар 20. Now you picked out one
idea normally. One thing you believe in, one thing you think you can make our world better, easier, healthier, greener. you can make our lives better. You can you make a difference in this fast-changing world. Okay. But now we have to make sure that your idea is able to go to the market. I mean, you have to deal with several aspects. That you find customers, that you see the environment, that you know how to develop your idea into a business. And there are several ways to do so. You need a business model. You need to know how you can make the difference and you can be sustainable. That what you are doing, your activities, you develop, that they, in the long term, can stay and exist and make a difference. And how to create value. And I've been working in the economics department at my university, and up till I think 3-4 years ago, we learned our students to make business plans. And it looks like this. You have the financial plan, and then you have the business idea, and then you have to write your future of your company, and then you have to write a chapter on your partner companies and on your markets, your customers. And at the end, all my students make like a 60-page book about their business, the way they think it should develop. And then we learned about this guy, Alexander Osterwalder, and you can Google it. There's lots of information on him and on what he has made on the internet. And he's also an economist, but he thought it should be more easy and flexible to work with. Because a business plan, it has to change because you have new ideas, and you have to adapt, and your market is changing. And you have, now, but before, you need to rewrite this chapter. Chapter customers, think about it again, it doesn't work. And if an investor needs to know your business, then you have to read 60 pages. Investors, they don't like to read 60 pages. They want to know it in 5 minutes or in one visual.
Yeah.
And that's why this Alexander guy, he made this business model canvas. And actually, it's an easy way, a one page with 9 building blocks to make your business visible. And it's easy to understand. And that's the thing we are going to use today to make your idea into a business. It forces you to think about the different aspects, important aspects, to make sure that your idea creates value in a sustainable way. That you can exist over years and adapt to a changing market, a changing environment. And I'm going to try to explain. You see, this is the model I've been putting it all also in Holly because you have to work with it later on. There are 9 blocks on it. And if you think about these 9 blocks and you have answers for your business in these 9 blocks, then you have like a main good idea to develop your business. Then you can start. If one block is missing, and it can be that you don't know the answers on all the blocks today, but if one block is missing, you have to rethink because something is not fitting there. If you don't know who your customers are, then you have a problem because who is going to buy your idea? Okay? I'm going to give a quick overview of the 9 blocks. They're quite easy to understand. That's the good thing about this plan. It's easy. But then, afterwards, you are going to try to change your idea or adapt your idea in this one-pager. So, the 9 blocks. On the right side, you see the blocks who are dealing with your idea. The first thing is, who is your client? Think about it. We have different profile of clients. Are you focusing only on elder people, only on young people, only on people who are interested in sports or are interested in gaming? You have to think about it. It can be different groups, but if you have different groups, you have a larger market, it's good, but it can cost you a lot more efforts as well, because you maybe have to adapt your product to each segment of customers. It's very important to know them very well, because it's also defining how you are going to attract them and how you are going to talk with them. And I will come back to that later on. The central issue on the paper here, can you show it again? That's why it's in the middle. the value proposition. This is also the thing Geert is going to tell about later on this afternoon, because that's the focus of what you are doing, the business you are developing. This is, you have to put over there, the reason why people are interested in your product or in your idea or in your service. This is the thing it's all about. You have to know it, and you have to tell, you have to be able to explain it quite easily. So, what is the added value? Why should people be interested in what you have been thinking of? Central issue. Okay, and then you have the customer segments. You know what is your USP, your unique selling proposition. How are you going to make sure that your customers are targeted? How can you reach the people who should be interested in what you are delivering?
I think of the spectacles example. That was a very smart move in the channels, that they just had a pop-up that people really had to try and get to buy the spectacles, and it was, they put it on Facebook or on another platform, but okay, we're now here on Snapchat too, we're now here, and people were like sending text messages, you can buy it there, over there. The same is what Apple does, scarcity. Apple, if there is a new iPhone or whatever, you can't buy it the first day. So you really have to try and buy it. That's a smart move. They have their own stores channeling.
Yeah, and it brings us to the relationship you're building with your customer. Depending on your service or your product, you can have another relationship. You know Nespresso, the coffee in small capsules? They have a special relationship with their customer. They make like a club. You are not just a customer who is buying something in a shopping mall. No. You can order it. We bring it to your home. At Christmas, there's a specialty in it. You're a special one. You're not a number. That's an explicit way of targeting your customer and opening the channel and having this special relationship. For cornflakes, it's different because you find it another way. It's another way of dealing with your customers.
If you have a premium product, some of you have good ideas already. If you have to think, is it premium? Do people pay a lot of money for it? Then I have to have a premium relationship. People have to feel, wow, I have it, I'm special, I am a VIP premium member. And you could do something like that.
Yeah. And then you don't want to have like an automatic mail, your number 500, wait, we will come back to you within 3 days. No. If you have paid a lot for a certain service or product, you are part of this club and you want to have a good service. And then you don't want an automatic mail.
Tesla has some charging stations all around Europe. It's free to recharge your Tesla. That's a premium customer relationship. You don't have to pay for your fuel. They provide it when you buy it.
And then, of course, your business needs to exist and to be sustainable. You need to know who is willing to pay? Where is the added value? Is it one time? Are you going to be able to sell your product and connect it with a certain service where you have like returning revenue every year, every month? These are things to think about. Sometimes it's not the user of your product who is paying for your product. If you have like, for example, an app which makes sure that your phone doesn't work when you're driving. I'm not willing to pay for it, but my insurance company wants, because when I'm not texting while driving, then I'm driving more safely, and the chances of an accident are less, are smaller. So my insurance company, if they have to pay my car when I'm texting and having an accident, it costs more. So think about it. It's not always income from your user, it can be another party.
Some of your groups have an app, an application, and what we really don't want to see anymore, it's typical, it's normal, is that students say, we built an app, where's the money, where's the revenue stream? Okay, they have to pay for their app. How many apps do you pay for?
How many apps on your phone are paid?
So the thing there is, you have partnerships. That's a bit of PR, public relations. You can have a partnership that IKEA donates some money if you do this or that, or maybe an ad, or think about smart ways of gaining money without letting your customer of the brochure app pay, for example.
It might be. Is it possible that your customer is paying for your product and his user as well? But most of the time, there are lots of people around who are also involved in your business, and they might support you in a way, or they might support your user in another way. And then, what do you need to make sure that your service is delivered or your product is made? What things are very essential to build your business on? Most of the time, you need some labor. I mean, you need people who do some effort to deliver your service. It's an important resource. In IT, probably also somebody who provides you hardware or components for your hardware, these kind of things. And then, what are crucial elements to make sure that your model is working, that your business is going on? You need selling activities maybe, or you need repairing activities if you have like technical aspects, these kind of things. Think about them. And then it's coming to this network as well, where we have about resource, about income, revenue streams. You need partners. They are interested. They want to support you. They want to support your user. Nowadays, to be an entrepreneur, you need this network. It's very difficult to be on your own, develop a product, go to the market, and have like this business. You need other people.
Who of you is on Facebook? Who's on Facebook? Raise your hands. Who is on LinkedIn? That's the real question. Okay, that is really every my students. They can't come in the class. They get sent home if they're not on LinkedIn. LinkedIn is for me a revenue stream. I find all my partners. Interesting people. Who's on Twitter? I found some partners through Twitter too. It's mostly in journalism.
It's very important. Sometimes you will discover that you have an idea and there is like one missing point. Everything fits, and then that aspect, I cannot make it, or I don't find the right channel, and then you have to use your network. You need partners to be able to target your customer segments or to be able to produce what you have developed. It's also important when you have to scale. You are prototyping something, but at a certain moment you need like more products because the market is opening up and it's very good. But then you need partners for doing this. It's very difficult to have like a plant and production and a million.
And then you can be creative. Is a good example. I had an idea driving in my car with Dirk, and at the back we had an idea for an app like some of you have today. And Dirk, where was the app made?
In
Ukraine. So first we went to an app builder in Belgium, said, great idea, it will cost you 100,000 euros to build the app. Then we went to another app builder in Antwerp, the best city in Belgium, said, good idea, but to make this app, it will cost a lot of money. It was 4 days later. We said, how much? 50,000. So they're just cowboys. Putting a price on an app, 100,000 for the same story, and we made the app for
1,000 euros.
Thanks to key partnering, internet.
Very important. Very, very important. And then the last building block to have like an overview on your business. What money do you need? Where is the money going to produce or to develop your idea, your service? It's not only your components, it's not only programming, it's labor, it's travel expenses, it's your sales channels. It's important to think about it because, it's an important aspect of the future of your company. If you sell something for 5 euros and it costs 10 euros to produce, then you have a problem. You have to think. Okay.
This is a problem for my company, for example. I have a one-man company. And I have to be there. I have to do the things always. But if you can sort of AI-wise optimize it, I don't have to be here, then my revenue can grow or my exponentially. But now my cost structure is also that I always have to be there to earn the money. It's
very important. You need to, as an entrepreneur, you also need to eat and to sleep and to don't forget these costs. You can maybe one day, 2 days, and then it's very difficult. So in your cost structure, also people need to be paid. It's not only things. We know today it will be very complicated to have these kind of things in detail, but it's important to be aware of these aspects of your business, okay? And so this covers the paper here for showing. This will be your model, business model canvas. It's up to you. One example, we gave some examples throughout the presentation. Skype, you can see. What is their USP? What's the reason people want to use Skype? It's free if you have internet access.
Start in the middle. Start with your value proposition.
Yeah. This is the important thing. You have to know what you are doing, what your unique thing is. And then it's interesting to see who's your user. Who wants to use Skype? Maybe you have to divide it. But in any case, Skype is used by people who have easily access to internet. That's an important aspect. You cannot be targeting like people who don't have access to internet because they cannot use Skype. Or it's very, very expensive. And then Skype is mass. They're not like a premium thing where you have like a one-on-one service for them. No, no. You get like automatic things and they are, it's one on thousands the way they communicate with their customers. So you see on the right side, it's the external aspect of the business of Skype. Then you see the way they are making their money, the channels they use, it's also the outside. If you see these aspects, they are telling something about the Skype business inside. Who are they working with? What are they doing? What do they need to do what they do? That's the way you can look at this business model canvas. And then, of course, you need to think about the costs, the financial issues are below. Make sure you think also about the added value here. Because maybe if you are doing something, if you have an idea for an hospital or a place where handicapped people can stay, it's also added a revenue stream. It's a revenue for society. It can be that government is willing to implement your things because you create added value in a social way. It's up to you. There are business model canvas hanging out. You have your unique ID. We heard very good ones. Try to make this one for your company. Your company on top here, fill out your team and the name of your team and maybe your product if you have an idea. And try to, with sticky notes, make up the business model canvas. It will come around and think with you. Do it with sticky notes because sometimes it's your customer, maybe it becomes a key partner if you think good about it. Or the way around. We are cooperating, well, actually, no. It will be my client. So it makes it flexible. This will be the basis for this afternoon's presentations. So this will make your idea into a business. This will make what you are thinking about, which is a good idea, you have to be sure that you can go to the market with that kind of idea.
These are the first questions a VC, a venture capitalist, an investor will ask, who is your client? How would you rate your product financially? What do they have to pay? So if you really want to become a businessman or an entrepreneur, you should have answers. And we'll give you some time for that.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll give you
45.
Half an hour. So you get until 12 o'clock. 12 o'clock. Is that correct? Half an hour. We'll come by. Then there is a break. You have a lunch break. And then at 1 o'clock, you come back. I teach you some presentation skills. Then you have to prepare, and at the end of the day, you present your business. All right, so till 12 o'clock, you do this in the hallway. Then you have your break. 1 o'clock, you come back here.
We are working around. Ask questions.
Let us help you. Good luck. Ready, set, go.
Back. Last part of today.
There's some things I hate about PowerPoint, and I figure it's kind of my duty.
I want to wrap up this morning's exercise, this morning challenge. You've been working on your business idea, and you've been brainstorming and been working it out on the business model canvas. Did it went well? Was it did it give you some insights in what you have been thinking about? Yes?
Yeah,
okay. Because we have only one day master classes, it's up to you to develop it further if you want to. Yeah? We try to give you some support in how you can become an entrepreneur. The next step is, if you have this idea, if you have it developed into a business plan, you have to convince people that it's a good idea. And that's what we are going to do the afternoon. So we are not working on the business model as such anymore. It's for you. You can work it out if you want to. If not, it can be like, I hope you learned something about it. Jeff will introduce you how you are convincing people. Short, powerful, that's what you want to learn. And we are going to practice. So you will need your ID later on to convince us and to win the beer.
Okay, thank you, Stan. Let's see if the gear works out. I had some movie fragments again. I'm trying to find them on YouTube too, and maybe display. This is a workshop I gave in Amsterdam on Monday. So one of the things I do at my own company is I teach. So I teach at the university college, but I also train companies. So I don't know if you know Sony Music. No? Sony Music? That's big. Music artists. I taught them in Amsterdam and in Brussels, and I'll try and explain some things about me. This is my difficult name. I look a bit weird and I look a bit tired. This is the reason. That is our baby. I have to wake up very early a lot of the times. And this is the thing we are going to do today. We're already doing it. My Chinese is really bad. Anyone? No? They told me yesterday, some students, they use Chinese and they're really good. Okay, this is the translation. Every workshop, every lesson I teach, it can be brought down to one sort of philosophy. I will tell you some things you will forget. The best check is always tomorrow morning when you have breakfast at 8, 9, 7:30, 11, if you're going out tonight. What do you still remember of what I was saying? Not a lot. My students also, they forget a lot. It's normal. But I will try and show you some things, and you'll remember. A visual presentation are the best presentations. Make it as visual as possible. Images are easier to stick with, and the best to learn something is involvement. That is why I'm very happy. We were a bit scared. We don't know how Belarusian students are. And if we do this exercise with our students, they have 100 post-its on it because we trained them and trained them. You only had one sort of a day. You only have one day. And maybe you're like, Jesus Christ, what is this? But if you get involved, you'll learn. It's with everything. And yesterday, it was Chinese for me, what Derek did with some of your students. It was like this and that and that. I was like, But if I would have jumped in the pool, I probably would have learned. That is the idea. Okay, on the menu for you guys and for Sony Music, three things. It's a presentation tip, if you can use your hands. Three things. First of all, this guy is like you. Very smart, was an MIT engineer in Massachusetts, and he said, screw it, I'm stopping with what I do with my job. because I'm in terrible meetings with a lot of shitty PowerPoints. I won't have it anymore. And he's become a very wealthy entrepreneur. What does he do? He travels around the world and he makes stand-up comedy only about PowerPoint mistakes. Full rooms everywhere. We'll see a short fragment if the computer holds it and the internet about him. I wrote a book, co-wrote a book about presentation tips. It's in Dutch. Didn't bring it. I don't know how your survival Dutch is. And the last thing is that you have to practice, and I'm very happy that there's a camera here. What I do with companies, I let everyone talk or present for 5 minutes, only 5 minutes, and then we tape it in HD, Sony also, and you look back at it with the sound, but also without the sound, but because I don't know if you know, but your body language is very important too. If you want to convince an investor, you have to stare him in the eye sometimes. Not too long, or it will get weird. Okay. And not with the girl in the back or something like that. But you have to sort of make a connection in Dutch, or in English it's bridging. You have to make a bridge. That's why I'm standing here too. I want you to connect, to think. I want to read your eyes. That is a good presentation. That are the three things. If you have a question, just raise your hand. If you say you are absolutely wrong, because it's only my opinion, you have to say it too, because it's always good. If you get mad, I love it. You get a lollipop if you get mad, because you're thinking with me. The worst thing you can do is do like this. There are always two in the room like this. No. Connect with me mentally. That is a good presentation. Any sort of reaction is a good reaction. This is the guy, the stand-up comedian, the researcher engineer who became a stand-up comedian. Let's pray for God and hope it works.
So here we go. Here's common PowerPoint mistakes. Number one, people tend to put every word they are going to say on their PowerPoint slides.
Don't do this. Stances, put it in the big.
This I don't dare do that. Ultimately, this makes your slide. You lose your audience's attention before you even reach the bottom of your first line. Please don't do that anymore, please. Number two, most common, many people do not run spell check. Big mistake. Nothing makes you look stupider than spelling errors. You've got a red line under it. Recheck the spelling. And finally, I hate this. Avoid excessive bullet pointing. Only bullet key points. Too many bullet points, and your key messages will not stand out. In fact, the term bullet point comes from people firing guns at annoying presenters. Hence the bullet point. Bad color schemes, not good. Clashing background and font colors can lead to distraction, confusion, headache, nausea, vomiting, and loss of water control. I can't stay on that one too long. Here's something I've noticed. The number of PowerPoint slides you have in your talk, the less useful your talk actually is. Unfortunately, my presentation is right there. Also notice this, people love to pack data in their presentation. They just shove more and more data, thinking it's better, but it's not. The more data you have, the harder it is to read your slide, and the effectiveness plummets. Now you can improve the effectiveness by adding some shading and some 3D effects, and some second order and third order effects. And I know, let's add some labels, that'll help a lot. And that's pretty much every marketing slide I've ever seen out there. It's not like VP marketing standing there going, it's real clear in Q4. What the hell are you talking about?
Okay, this is an interesting slide because one of my boss at the university college, she's a researcher, very smart lady, and I really had a fight, an argument with her. She said, Geert, if I have to give a presentation about research, My slides have to look like this. It's the only possibility to give a presentation. I said, no way. You don't do it like that. How could you do that? Any ideas? How would you, if you have a lot of data, how would you present it like this all the time? Because people are doing this, huh, in the audience. After 4 or 5 slides, it's impossible to keep your attention. What they do in advertising a lot is that they present the insights. And like I tried to do this morning, you have a sort of trend and you give sort of an idea, but you don't present all of the small details. And what you can do is you have a sort of management summary with all the extra information numbers, and you can give it to them to reread it all. But you present sort of the translation. If you want to score high with your presentation, I want your presentation to be visual and to try and have a story. What is your story? The cool thing is, I will show you some things how to make visual slides easy and free. There are some great new tools online. But the thing is, you can also come without any slides. The best presentation I have ever seen was Malcolm Gladwell, a New Yorker writer, and it was 1 week after Steve Jobs, you know, from Apple, died. And he came on the stage and he said, well, I'm very happy to be here. I have a lot of slides. I'm not using it because I want to tell you 3 stories I wrote in the New Yorker. Steve Jobs hasn't invented anything, so he's a sort of a thief. Let me tell you why. First story. First story why Steve Jobs is a thief, and everyone was like, we're 2,000 people. And I was like drooling a bit, Jesus Christ. He was a very good storyteller, and he had structure. He said 3 stories. Story 1, this happened, and I went there, and that happened. This is my first story. My second story. And everyone was captivated. So if you have the cojones, that's Spanish for ball, if you have the balls, if you have the balls, and you can come and give your presentation later on, and you have no slides, but you have a story, you might win the duel, the devil. Don't need slides, especially not the Don McMillan slides full of bullet points, and people don't like it. I had one team, I eavesdropped, I had one team said, yeah, but our idea, we have an app already, and it works like that. Fantastic. If you want to convince an investor, and you can show something, or you bring something, say, yeah, well, today we're talking about this. You might think, oh, what's this? But you get people captivated again. Don't let them be the rabbits staring at the slides all the time. Then you get a sort of impact. That might be an idea for you. That's me with hair. What happened? The thing is, when I ask this to my students, they never say, oh yeah, slides like that. We don't do that anymore. How does that work here? Do you still have slides with a lot of bullet points? You see? Yes? No? Not really. That's good. Slides, in my opinion, should be more visual. If I go to companies, that's weird. A lot of the Don McMillan kind of slides still happen at big companies. Sony is a cool company. They have all these artists, Kanye West and all these things. But still, their slides are a bit corporate, acceptable in the 80s vibe. Okay? Hope today we don't see that slide, those slides. The 10 pointers I want to give you to become a better presenter. The first thing is good news for you guys. You're smart. If you have something smart to tell, if you have good research, if today one of you says, I will ask a question, Stan and Dave will ask questions too, and if one says, yeah, okay, but is there a market for this kind of product? And you can say, yeah, well, I've done some research and it seems that this and this happens in that country and so, that will be cool. If you have a sort of idea and you can base it on research, even better. The thing a lot of people forget, and I'm glad we can give you some psychology too, is if you present, you don't have to present all. You can in your team pick one, the best, or with a sidekick or a side chick. That works well if you have 2 people presenting. Try and find the best sort of things in those presenters. Every presenter is different. I'm very different than Stan in some ways, and Dirk too. And the cool thing is, if you have 12 minutes, go to this website, today. I know it's Saturday. It's free. 16personalities.com. It's free. And it will give you four letters. It's the MBTI. A lot of people have it on their LinkedIn. They have four letters. My LinkedIn MBTI is this. I'm actually introvert. And when you do the test, it's a sort of test. One of the questions is, do you get everywhere on time? I do. It's not good for me because I always have to wait. But I can't come late. It's something wired in my brain. You have all these questions. 16personalities.com gives you a lot of insight in the things you're good at and the things you really suck at. And you can build on the good things. Okay? Then, if you really will, want to become an entrepreneur, I already said this morning, who's on LinkedIn and only half of you, I think the other half should come on LinkedIn, go on LinkedIn too. And I even have a dirty story for you. Pieter Baagt is one of the better entrepreneurs in Belgium. And he says, I just want to earn 100,000 euros with my own company, it's me, a year. And roughly I divide it in 10 clients, 10,000 euros for each client. So I have a new client through LinkedIn and I have a first meeting. Pieter Baagt has two LinkedIn profiles. Pieter Baagt with his picture on and Wesley Janssen with no picture. And every time he has a new client, Wesley Janssen looks at the new client's LinkedIn profile, like a Facebook profile for her. And then he comes there and then he knows a lot about the person in question without the person knowing that Pieter looked at it. So if you want to impress us today, maybe you should check our LinkedIn profile and see what they're up to, and maybe we can find a link. That is a bright spot. What Pieter Baagt does is he comes 10 minutes early always. If he's an hour early, he waits in his car. Then he goes in and he looked, she studied in that same place as me. He comes in and says, I'm very happy to be here. Why? Yeah, I studied here. You studied here too. I studied here too. And they make a connection there. But he just scanned the LinkedIn profile. It's a bit of psychology of limits. The big why and limits. People have sort of expectations you can try and fill in. If I give a presentation, I never work at it alone. I'm not that smart. The book I've written about presentations is way smarter than I am about presentations, because 15 people read and reread the book and said, Keith, no, don't do this. You should look at the Don McMillan, put it in a book, do that. So if you can pull together your knowledge, you will become smart. These are my colleagues. They help me with everything. This is a Steve Jobs quote. And it works for me too. If I call someone for help, I don't know anything about it. I did a press conference when I was 24 an international star, I forget his name. He wanted to become president of Haiti. And he was in Belgium. It was at a sort of music festival. And I had to do it. And he said, yeah, you do it. I said, I said, Jesus Christ, I've never organized a press conference. But I just call my brother, who is a journalist, some other people, and ask, and they help. The idea always is ask other people to help, and network always. The second one is the same sort of situation. How can you lose this presentation today? That is when it becomes very difficult for us to understand. We're idiots. You have to make your story idiot-proof. What I sometimes do if I have a big pitch, a big presentation, is I go to my grandmother. This is not my grandmother. And I say, grandma, how are you? And I have to watch out because after two or three sentences, she wants to talk about the war 50 years ago, so I have to fight between them. But then I say, one thing, grandma, in 4 days, I have to give a presentation. About this and that. And she says, what? About what? And I make it simpler and simpler. The brightest minds, the smartest people I know, they make it really simple. If you want to win today, use simple words or use a sort of image. You say, it's a bit like this or a bit like that. Don't get into the bits and bytes all the time. That is my presentation point. So run away from the computer. the worst thing you can do is just always be on the computer. And what I tried to this morning with you is go outside, have an idea, get a sort of approach on your presentation. What do you want to tell? What I often do is I take a big piece of paper like Stan has, and I draw 20 things like that. And I start drawing. I'm the worst. You know what this is?
Flower.
A flower, he says. It's an ostrich. I'm the worst drawer there is, but it doesn't matter. Try and set up your mind. Okay, maybe this is the first slide, and then I talk about that. Before you go to the computer, it's awesome. If you talk about bright minds and great presentations, one of the best is Hans Rosling. I'm not sure if I'm going. I have a great movie clip. He recently died, but you can go to his website yourself, HansRosling.com. You should check it out. And the cool thing is about Hans Rosling is he gave one of the best presentations with a lot of data. He came on the stage and he had a washing machine. And he said, well, let me tell you, that was his start, why this washing machine is here. Well, when I was a young boy, and he tells a story about the first time there was a washing machine, and then he connects the washing machine to a lot of global problems, and in the end he comes back to his personal story. But if you can bring something, fire up your structure, in this case, with a washing machine. Check it out yourself. Yeah, the movie is here, I can try, but this works. That would be great. Five more tips and then we're clear. Another tip if you want to become a good presenter is you repeat and rephrase. You won't win today, because I hate it, when you come in front of the class and you do like this. Okay, we invented this, this is that, this is that. It's not a reading exercise. If you want to win today, you need to be able to look at us and present. Use your arms and not read. So I'm curious to see who stands up with the cojones, which is Spanish for
bolo.
There you go. One thing you know. And you use it, you try and do it in your own words. So don't be like a dictionary, Talk like you would talk to us in a pub. Maybe not to Stan Kuhne after 1 o'clock, but try and talk to us in a pub, like we are. That is how you become a good person. This is Kanye West. What is special about this Kanye picture? He almost never smiles. You have these gifs, I could put them in, but they wouldn't play. He's like laughing, and then the camera zooms in on him, and he's like, and he has attitude. Smile is often something that is forgotten. Sometimes I have my students come in and they say, oh yeah, he says we have to smile when we start. And, we do like this, and they do like this. They're outside and they come in and do like this. That's drying your teeth. It's not smiling. A real smile, a real sort of, is with some fire in your eyes that you look and you say, okay, I'm happy to be here. So I hope when you come on stage, you're in a positive mindset, and you're like, I'm happy to be here. Let's go. You have that kind of body talks. This is the first face palm in history. I still make a lot of presentation mistakes. I'm not the best, and that is good. You have to be yourself. I always say you can't be an expert if you haven't made every mistake possible, because you learn most from your mistakes. Might be the case that someone is here and says, okay, I have the cojones, I will not bring the paper, and I have a sort of blackout. I'm like, what was our idea again? Jesus Christ, fuck. If you do that in my college, university, in my lesson, you get more points than if you come here and read. That's always crazy the first week. After the first few times, my students, they know it, and it's very positive because they say, okay, screw it, and they talk. But it's a mental barrier you should get over. It's very good that you make. Champagne is filled white wine. So somebody tried to make white wine, and said, Jesus Christ, it failed, and then it was champagne. So beautiful things can come from screw-ups. That is the answer. Typical nervous problems. When you're nervous, what can happen? You can get very red in the face. It's like an oil, it's like, it comes like this. It happens. It happens to me too. What should you do? You have a red face. Never present? Any ideas?
Get over it, mother. Get over it.
Get over it? What I always say is, very good, is talk about the elephant in the room. If you have a red face, say, I probably have a red face. And people are like, That is good. Why is that good? Because I'm a bit nervous, because the things I'm going to say now are pretty important to me. Let's go. And that is a way of saying, and then it will, mostly it will disappear. But if you're saying like, I'm probably a red face, that in your mind it gets worse and worse. So talk about the elephant in the room. With armpits, I don't know if I have one. Could be very, mind your, Dirk, could you show? Dirk has.
It's because I'm working.
I thought I smelled something. Mind your outfit. Mind your outfit, obviously. I had students, I don't know how to call it in Belarusian, but who did the sort of the bandage, you know, here. No, I can't explain it. It's a dirty word. Put bandages in. That was crazy, too. But mind, if you have a white shirt and it's all wet here, it's a bit, so if you have a darker or something like this, you won't see it that much. Shaky hands. What I will do is, I will put this here. If you don't have slides, fine. If you have slides, great. And this. This is fantastic if you're nervous. You're mostly nervous the first 2 minutes of every presentation. It's with everyone. It's with me too. What happens if we tape you is your shoulders are a bit higher. Your breathing is a bit higher too. You're like, and you just have to release some tension. And if you do this, nobody sees that I'm releasing tension. I'm nervous. I'm killing it right now. And you relax. That is a very good pointer the first 2 minutes. If you're a bit smaller, you can do this. I'm killing the table, nobody knows, but I'm releasing that first built-up pressure. That is a good way. I always have this. What is dangerous? It's this. You know what happens? I had it a couple of times. Yeah, very good. This one, there's another one. There's another one. Someone like you was like, heard something of my lecture and says, yeah, I have to push the pen. And they're like, and they're pushing the pen. Oh, nobody sees, I'm releasing pressure. And then the pen breaks, and it shoots that way or that way. Pupil in her eye. I had it one time, and the class didn't talk to him for 2 weeks. They thought he was a psycho, because they didn't know the trick, and he did it like crazy. So you'll have 2 or 3 weeks to blend in into the group again. This is a very good pen, because you can't click it, and you can kill it like crazy. If you can break this, I'm buying a drink. Right? Shaky hands. Why can't you bring any paper? It's because paper will exaggerate your shakiness. No paper. Just you. And me. You push this and you talk. That's what you do. This is what you all suck at. Because I sucked at it too. And that is, when you go into a presentation, your vibe always, almost always is negative. You're like, oh Jesus Christ, I didn't have time enough to prepare, the slides suck, it's bullet points, I can't do it, I'm getting red. You're a sort of negative circle in your mind. And it's a vicious circle, it gets worse and worse. What did Pia Helmbout, is a Belgian athlete, do before she had the Olympic gold medal in high jump? She sat down, close their eyes, and this is research has shown, this is what a lot of athletes do, close their eyes, and she does the ideal jump in her mind. And then she does like this, positive attitude, come on, help me. She just did it in her mind, she does like that. She's not sitting there, this can go wrong, this can go wrong. And that is what a lot of people do. So try and get a positive flow going before you get into the presentation. What's the best way of, I tell a stupid joke, people laugh, this happens, then this slide, everything works, the movie fragments works, great. You have to get in, if you want to become a winner in business, you have to become a winner in your head. Yeah. I don't know, I'm really old. Any one of you has ever seen Cool Runnings? No, I'm old, so this is very... Cool Runnings is a real story about the Jamaican bobsleigh team. And they don't have any snow in Jamaica. And in Canada, 20 years ago, they won a silver medal. I was like, huh, you don't... But they have good runners, Jamaican runners. And then, but what did they do the night before they got their medal? They were in the bathtub, in the bath, eyes closed. First one, second one, third one. The ideal run in their head. But a lot of in advertising, they sometimes have to present for 1 million euros, they have to win a client over. And what one of the funny advertising agencies always did to release tension is they danced. So if you dance in the hallway in an hour or two, it's fine. They danced, say, let's do this, Jesus Christ, and then they came in. Positive attitude. Not, I'm about to die, Jesus Christ, I hate my life, give me a gun. Not that attitude. We don't know each other that well yet, but I'm not the best in character. So I will ask one dirty question. One question you will say, huh? What's that for a question about our brother, Jesus Christ? You always have three reactions of students. The first reaction is they get mad. This is a very difficult question, Jesus Christ. The second reaction, if there were two or three people, is that's a difficult question. And then the one in the middle looks right, and the other one does like this. And then the left one does like this. I'm very good at everything, he says. Does like this, like a gorilla. Mostly it are men, and he says, good question, yes, we did the research, and obviously this and this, and the other, what he doesn't see is the other two are like killing him with his eyes, and the jury sees, yeah, he's lying, that is also not a good. If you get a difficult question, which investors often ask, you don't, what could you say? There's nothing wrong with saying, good question, let me look at my colleagues. We'll have to do some extra research. Can we get back to you and send you an email or give you a call? But you just, it's just, investors, they mostly invest also in people. Your ID can change, but if they see the right sort of mindset, if you're honest, if you're upbeat, if you're smart thinking, then they will give you the money. Okay? So that might, this is a very dangerous part because most investors, investors I see, they're not really interested in the whole shebang and a lot of slides. They just want the idea, and then they want to start and interact with you. The best presentations are interaction, are conversation. Okay, last pointer. We're there. We made it. Why is that? This is the last time I use the word cojones. You can be sure of it. If you say Jesus Christ here, Fallon, I'm better at presenting than you, it can be possible. I will show you. I want an extra challenge. I will give you this challenge. Before you come up, your breathing is a bit higher normally. You drink 2 gulps of the sparkling water. What happens next? You say, welcome everybody. And it's like a burp sticking here, and it's like, I had it 2 times. It was only sparkling water, and I was talking, yeah, this is a very good idea, and it was not good. Not good. So sparkling water is a tricky thing to drink before a presentation. If you're not good at visualization of slides, I have one last movie fragment, you know. Anyone, do you know Hyperdeck? Free software? Anybody?
it's free software, and when you type in a word, you immediately get the pictures in the software online. And you can find great pictures, in 5 minutes you have a cool looking presentation. And the cool thing is the pictures are all high resolution and Creative Commons, which means you can use them, you're not stealing them. You show it on your smartphone, tablet. You can use it for today if you want. Hi, good day. This is a website you can start for free. If you make a presentation, in which program do you make it?
PowerPoint.
Always PowerPoint? That's by PowerPoint. PowerPoint zombies.
Maybe Prezi.
Maybe Prezi, yeah, okay. Yeah, now I have Prezi next. Mind, you do have good PowerPoints. I don't see them a lot. It's a lot of bullet points mostly. You can make a great presentation in PowerPoint and Keynote. They're only tools. But if you want to have a visual presentation, try emails for free. Try Haiku Day for free. And my favorite tool nowadays is Canva. Canva is a great tool. So, you can go to the website if you want. This is another workshop I give, and then I teach all these programs. Prezi next. I see a lot of really bad Prezis. You can make, it's just a tool, you can make car crashes in Prezi too. But Haiku Deck, emails, Canva, they are very visual. And it's easy to build up a story. 10 minutes, every one of you, because you're smart and it's intuitive, can make a crazy presentation convincing a Silicon Valley investor in 10 minutes technically. Content-wise, you have to think about your story. These are guys like you, Project. Hi. Project, there were two guys bored by PowerPoint and they just made their own. They made their own sort of visualization tool. It's also free. It has a bit of coding in it, but that is that. And this is the last thing, recordings and feedback. So if you want to become better at presenting, obviously you have to practice a lot, you have to fail forward, fail, get better, and you do best by taping yourself. I used to bring this to class, and now students just tape it with their smartphone. And then they take the bus home and they watch it and they say, Jesus Christ, why am I always doing this and that? And this is a very good way of learning things you don't notice yourself by checking it on tape. Tape never lies. Yeah? Okay. Feedback is the breakfast of champions. You only get better by getting feedback. This is a movie fragment we can't show. And that is the idea. You have to find that Spanish word, grab it, and you have to jump in and say, let's do this. I'm going to kick ass, I'm going to drink the duvel, and I'm going to lie on the sidewalk with my head around the curve. Okay? Thank you for sitting this one out. If you're hungry for more, I always do follow-up. If you say, Geert, what was that? Or could you give me the slides? Or I have a problem with this. I always get a wet spot here when I start presenting. It's crazy. You have any pointers for that? Just send me an email. I will always respond within one day. So if you have any further questions, by all means. I find your greatness. Okay? Thank you, guys. See you in... how are we going to do it?
Maybe for an hour preparing?
Okay, let's do it like that. What
you
we
can,
want...
You can... I mean, your story is based upon your business. That's the idea. We need 1 hour. You will get the opportunity to present to us. Winners take the beer and the chocolate. Okay. Very important is that you get in the business model canvas, you get your value proposition right, because that will be the basis of your story. Visualize it, deal with the tips Geert told you, and bring it to us. Convince us that this is the million dollar idea for your business. But failing is an option. It's you have to exercise, and today is a good opportunity, I think, to exercise. So our idea was you finalize your business model if it's not ready yet, and you work on your presentation, and at 3:45 we start presenting it.
Yeah, one,
two.
Okay, let me give you to end with. This is if you want to become a, if you really want to invest for people giving you money, VCs, business angels. This is the typical setup. So if you want to be a classical sort of prepare a classical pitch, you have five slides. Your first slide is who are you? So you come in, you get your 5 minutes of fame, and you say, welcome, very happy to be here. We are team Popcorn Hot Shots Shower Curtain. I don't know what their name is, but you have a sort of name. And then you say, second slide, there is a big problem. There is a problem that this and this isn't solved, and you have a sort of a story about the problem. We have a solution. Slide three, this is our idea. We will solve this problem like this and do like that. And then, of course, if you want to have to talk slide four about markets. These people are going to buy it. This will happen. This is how the business will work. Think about the business model canvas. And the last slide, classically, is any questions? Do you have any questions?
No bullets.
Pictures.
But this is a structure you have to have in mind. This is the way we are going to understand your story and make the connection. Okay?
So, last thing up, you have 1 hour, and in 15:45, you get 5 minutes each to present your idea, your brilliant idea. Good luck.
5 minutes, huh? 5 minute presentations, maximum.
Maximum, yeah. Okay?
1 hour or 2 hours?
Sorry, 1 hour. 14:45. Then we start. Okay? So take a seat in the hallway in the other class. Start preparing. If you have problems with making visual slides, I will help. Okay? Good luck. Ready, set, go.
Jury is ready. We believe you are ready as well. Positive imaging, you can do this. Yes, beer and chocolates are waiting for the best ones. But everybody is a winner right now.
Yeah, if you dare to come up, you don't have to come in all your team. You can send out one or two, sidekick, sidechick. You can come with everyone if you want to say, we are a company with four of us. Doesn't matter. The cool thing is about presentation styles is you have a lot of different presentation styles, and it's not said that the fluent most fluent one will win, because your idea is a very important part. Focus on welcoming us as an investor, telling who you are, what the problem is, what your idea is, some market, and we'll ask some questions. You have 5 minutes each. Any questions now? Who wants to start? No one? We all go home and we bring the table. Okay, you guys start. Look at them. Perfect. So you can use slides, you can tell a story. Here is, I have a moment.
We're a group of enthusiastic senior engineers, so we basically work here, as you all may know already. We're basically made to come here. So the troubles in our current world, right? There are gadgets everywhere. We need a ton of them in our everyday life, so where do we put them? And the idea we've come up with was to put them in our clothes, which, to start off, we decided to use our boots. with boots, we are constantly going somewhere, so that's an energy, and an energy we can put to use somewhere. If we put some batteries in our boots and make some power generators, which would use the energy of walking or jogging or whatever you're doing with your boots, then we have a renewable energy supply. What this energy can do for us? For example, when let's imagine you are a professional dancer, right? You will often use some player for your music. It's a dance sport, and this player requires energy. When you are dancing, you are moving, you are using your boots. And if your boots have this power generator, which will use your movements to generate power, you can basically have a free energy supply for your music device. It also can charge your smartphone, obviously, or even laptop for a limited period of time. This idea obviously can expand further. I mean, with boots, for example, you can use some medical stuff, like if you have some feet problem or whatever, you can enhance your boots with some gadgets. And all the other kinds of clothes. So our business is not only about energy in boots, but it can go further. So, yeah, do you have any questions?
Okay. Questions? It might be a good idea to ask a difficult question now, if you want to, which try and make him sweat a bit. I'm looking at the jury. Question, technical question, money question. How much would it cost to make that? You have any idea how much it would cost?
Billions would cost. It's basically a conductor with some power supply and some power generator, which is very light. The technology itself might be costly, but it goes into mass production.
Very good.
Расскажи, что можно менять то, что стоимость выходит по сам ботинок, но можно заменять энергию.
The price depends. On your boots itself. I mean, if you want some fancy boots, it costs $1,000. We obviously cannot sell it to you.
Do you know what a venture capitalist will ask? He will ask, how much do you need? How much do I need to invest?
Right.
And why?
And that's a good question.
Can you start with 10,000 euros? Do you need 100,000 euros? Do you need a million?
A million.
Next question is why? And what does it cost? Think of the business model canvas. What is your cost structure then?
Well, the main thing which will cost is obviously the power generator, because it's something innovative and it has to have some experience. So that would be the one to cost. Also, if we will conduct some shoe factories and battery factories, the cost might go down significantly.
Is it your ambition to have this kind of feature in every shoe? And do you think, like, if you can manage to make this, that within 10 years every shoe has like this charger in it?
Oh, that would be ambitious, right? But that would also be great. I mean, is a renewable energy, and it is ecologically friendly, and, well, everything that is ecologically friendly is beautiful.
Okay, great.
Let's give them a hand. They started. Very good. Who's ready to fill the electrical boots now? Who's up next? Only one team, give them the duo.
Yeah.
Who's next?
Вам наши сотрудники сказали привет, поэтому давайте, след вы не страшно. Встаем и идем.
Always, it's difficult with my students too. Can you give me a number from 1 to 20? 20? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 100, 101, 102, 103, 104, 105, 106, 107, 108, 109, 110, 111, 112, 113, 114, 115, 116, 117, 118, 119, 120, 121, 122, 123, 124, 125, 126, 127, 128, 129, 130, 131, 132, 20. It's the team in the back.
Come on, guys.
I love this slide already. This is what I mean with a visual slide. This is very good. Good start already. So guys, if you feel ready, take the floor, do your best. It doesn't have to be perfect. Perfect is boring. The best of luck.
Okay, again, hi everyone. We are Way Up Team. I'm German, Nikita, Tom, Stas, and Marina. So we now want to introduce you our idea. And first question, do you have children? Actually, it doesn't matter because one day everyone will become a parent. Yes? And the only thing that matters for us, are you prepared? Next slide, please. So what is our aim? Our aim is to prepare you for this special moment. So, let's have a baby. But in a virtual reality. So our aim, we want to prepare future parents or young parents for this special moment, to have a baby, to develop their parent skill, to make them feel more comfortable when they will go to this moment. And that's why our main clients are future and young parents. And also, we are really interested in like ask some companies that organize some kind of courses for young moms or parents to develop their skills. We want to sell them our app to use them to make these courses more intense, more comfortable, and parents will feel much better after that. So this is our market, and yeah, this is, will be an app in a virtual reality, and we will sell it. We will make some YouTube videos. We will make a website. We will sell it in Play Market, Windows Store, Apple Store. We will. Our key partners are government, of course, because the government like these social projects. They like the idea of making more children in a country, yeah, making more people in a country. So, yeah, that is our idea, and that's all. Thank you. Do you have any questions?
Okay.
Very good.
A lot of discussion in the back. How we're going to do it like this and not like that.
A question. A virtual baby. I think when I looked at your business model canvas, really smart in the market, sort of. Could you explain it again? Who would buy it? Only students? Or who would buy the virtual baby?
Yeah, okay. So first of all, our customers are future and young parents. Mm-hmm. Then, again, children as a game, can use our app just to, I don't know, practice or just playing a game like Sims or something like that, but in virtual reality. So, and also...
Would there be a possibility to do it in augmented reality? In
yes, exactly, reality? Exactly, augmented reality, yes. Augmented reality, so like you just put your glasses and have a baby here on a table. So.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah. So
you can use this app.
I just don't know what.
Does the smell go with it as well? Does the smell go with it as well in augmented reality?
Yeah, maybe in future releases the smell, but
yeah. For MVP we will have only touches. Okay.
Any
questions? Yes.
How much the app will cost?
Okay. Really, it will not cost so much because, like, for to download it from an app store or any market, mobile market, it will not cost so much. Like, I don't know, average like $10, yeah, for an app. But our main customers that will make us money will be these companies with courses because they will buy our. We like do some features for them exactly to do some special features for them to like adapt our app for these courses more. Not like
a special feature like
yes.
The baby's crying all the time.
Yeah. Or I don't know, some tutorials maybe with this thing. Yeah.
Here, can I comment?
Yeah.
I think I was with you when you were filling out the business model canvas, and the way you have been thinking about the customer segments and broaden it is very strong. Eh? The first was only the young parents or the people who become parents. Now you have like enlarged your market, and I believe you're more than like an hour ago. So it's very good, very good.
And I would suggest to give the app for free, but you could definitely gain more on companies.
Partnership.
Because you now the company know that your market, the people using your app, are people interested in babies. Mm-hmm. And this only that's very nice, because then they can address these, for instance Pampers, or for instance anything else.
Yeah.
So we can make a small banner out of it, or just now you know that people using the app, they are already interested in things.
Yeah, if they would use the diapers brand in the app without really knowing, it's fun, it's the diapers app, and they pay
yes.
as a currency, that is a very smart way. If you would make this app, they will always say investors, first get people playing, and then we'll invest money. So most of the times it's free, and then people start doing it, and then the companies come in because you have a network and an audience. Let's give them a hand. Two very marketable ideas. I hope not every one of you thinks, okay, it's done. This is only the beginning. You could start a company with this too. Next up. Very good, guys. Who's next? There you go. Yeah.
Yes.
Do you want to present our project?
Next one.
We think that anyone has some problems with sleep. There are a lot of noises at the night, for example, in summer nights, your pillow becomes so hot that you wake up and turn around. Yeah. But I think that we found a solution. We want to create a smart pillow that can be as cold as you want. And we think that your sleep will become more deeper and comfortable. We think that our product will be very affordable. We think that we want it to be less than $15 for a pill. But we think that the price can raise up to $100 or maybe higher. We think that we also can add some extra features if they won't raise the cost so much. We can add, for example, an alarm clock and some other stuff.
Okay, thank you. Smart pillow. Questions? What could we ask?
Where can I buy one? No, I have to say I'm a very intense sleeper. I like sleeping. I'm very intense, but I always have problems with my pillow. That's true. So even this night, I have to throw away my pillow to get one. So I would buy one.
That's not a question. could you? Try an investor would say, okay, you said thermostat in the pillow, but what else is possible with the smart pillow? Is it only one idea, a thermostat, hot, cold, or are other possibilities with the pillow?
Maybe we can use built-in speakers that you can listen, for example, a lullaby
yep, good.
For the sleep.
Yeah.
And it will be more comfortable than using some headphones because there are a lot of wires and.
Okay. And then what is the hardware? Is it just a normal pillow or is it a special sort of pillow with software on it or how does that work?
There will be some special hardware inside the pillow that will help it to become taller. And the thing that you can control this pillow using your phone, you can set the temperature that you prefer and for example, to know some special features.
Okay. Any other questions?
Like what about softness after you add like speakers and thermostat and another kind of mechanism, it, will it be still like pillow, comfortable, soft and stuff like that?
Oh yeah, I'm good sell it.
I think that we need to think more about the but I think that it will be quite easy to add some light speakers to our pillows. And we think that our thermostat won't be so large that it will give you some uncomfort. That will give you some better.
Yeah, you have your first client over there, so that's good. Thank you, Team SpongeBob. Thanks. Okay, hello everybody. We are Common Essam, awesome Bumblebee. Please.
What do you see here?
Nothing.
So that's what the blind people see, literally nothing. And they're still humans. They need to communicate, to interact, to be among their society. The modern solution looks like this. I mean, it can look like this, but it's not very helpful. Because the dog cannot talk. The dog can provide you the contact, the interaction with other people. You cannot chat online, for example, with other people. You cannot be a part of more, a decent part of the community. As you may see, the blind people, don't really have much friends. And you know that. Without friends, a person, a human being cannot be a part of the society of the community. So, we have our solution for
We're living in 22nd century, so we have lots of tech, VR and cell phones, and really a lot of computing power. So. Why we don't use it for like helping blind people to see the context? So technologies like computer vision and AIs and something like that can really improve their lives. And our idea is to create a device that can use the power of a regular cell phone, like big things that they have like 8 cores and. A lot of pressing power, so this device wouldn't be very expensive because of using power from our phones and different sensors can help us to like see the environment and computer can analyze and sensors like face recognition can see the person and say to you that oh it's your friend and it's mine. You can say hello to him and something like that. So it really helps us to socialize. And like AI can help us to do things like chatting and social networks. It can describe a new post in Instagram from your friend and can describe you a landscape you can't see. But with this system, you can really. Live full life without any additional help
And as for our markets, we thought that it will be cool to distribute them through the rehab centers that help blind people, and we hope that like different foundations and government support will help us to develop this system, and it wouldn't be very expensive for end users, so not everybody can buy like a $10,000 system, which will be cool and great and help them to live a full life, but it's too expensive, so it's important to keep prices as low as possible, so as many people as possible can get an access to this system. Yes. So, with this system, they wouldn't need any help anymore. They can live their full life, and they can interact with other people. They can basically see, because the computer will describe everything. They can come in shop and see like prices and different items, and it's really help them improve their life, we believe. So, any questions?
I repeat one phrase, that the main purpose of this project to socialize the blind people, not to go from one dot to another dot.
Yes.
It's not a problem for now, but to socialize, because now blind people live separately from other society, and in 21st century it's very strange.
Main problem is that current system, there are systems like that, but combining things like computer vision and AI can help us to really just explain people what they could see if they wasn't blind, and help them to be more. Yeah.
Okay.
It can help make their lives easier in multiple communities.
Yeah.
So, for instance, we would do face recognition, but also emotion recognition.
Yes.
So the system would say there's somebody in front of you, he looks angry.
Yeah.
Or smiles.
Smiles. It's really helps you to understand other people's emotions, and it's much easier to communicate this way, or when you just stand and don't understand anyone.
And would you implement the artificial intelligence algorithms on a data server or something? Or do you
we thought about using like existing systems from Google and Facebook. They already have a big system that actually works excellent, and it will help us to reduce cost as well. We don't need to reinvent something like that. So
you would do some deep learning or something, or anything that has already been learned by artificial intelligence. Okay.
Any other questions?
You can.
Some feedback or remarks. First thing about the presentation, by asking us a question, I was immediately into your story. So it's very good to.
Best setup.
This
is a very good setup.
Yeah, well done. And then the other thing is, and it's something which is also very important in entrepreneurial thinking, but the day was too short. For example, you are targeting a customer segment which you don't know yourself by experience. You're not blind. So in developing your business, it will be very important to go in interaction very soon with your users. It's something we see very often.
That's why I talk about collaboration with rehab centers, so they can like they really knew what blind people need.
But you have to do it very quickly. But maybe they will tell you, we don't have a problem you think we have, and then you are looking for a solution for a problem that doesn't exist. I don't know. Eh? I believe your story was okay. But this is something we, and also a lot of technical people do.
they make a problem, then they make a very good solution, and then afterwards nobody buys it because the problem did not exist. It's very important. They call that design thinking.
So short feedback loops with clients. It doesn't have to be the full product, but you go into contact with the potential client.
Sure. Very good. And I'm happy that that there is one business ID for a societal added value. I'm happy with that.
Yeah. A lot of good value for the society.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Hans. We saw some great visual presentations, and again, I'm very happy to see you use another tool, you experiment. So if you think you're ready, Team Planet Express.
Okay, excuse me for the time. Good day, my name is Victoria, and the name of our team is Planet Express. Our team consists of four members, and our product name is Brewery One, Everyone Brew. It's a brewery for make a beer.
Our problem is that there is so much kinds and different sorts of beer in the world, but maybe someone want to create their own, try themselves in making beer. So. We decided to give them an opportunity to do this. So our idea is everyone brew. Everyone can try themselves in making beer. So you can make beer and you know what it is made of. And you made it with love, you can share it with your neighbors, or maybe you can try to make your own company and try to compete with Budweiser or Heineken or someone else. And you know exactly that there are no any chemical elements in this beer, and you can drink it safely without any danger to yourself. But not everyone can allow or maybe or want to spend their time for making this. So we know that it will be a hard path,
And also I want to tell you that we want to make an app with the recipe of a beer. It was a famous beer like a Heineken or Tuborg. We add your app into Apple Store or Windows Store or Play Market and buy a famous recipe, for example, for 99 cents or no other cost.
Yes, if there is a possibility if you want to try something, to try making famous beer with yourself, it's to buy a recipe and then try it make at home, or share your recipe in the community and maybe something like that.
Okay, not at all. I want to. Say more concrete about technical moments, if you want. And we already have a prototype of this system, and we have...
Already,
yes. This was one of our course projects, yes. And we have application, when you can choose hand mode or automatic mode of producing beer, some hardware and software component, controller component, which control all these processes in bucket. For example, heating element, read data from temperature sensors, and so on. So we know that this project is not so expensive, as you see, And we have experience in making all these component works. And now this is all made.
Any questions?
Okay, thank you for your time. If you have got any question, you may ask it to us.
Thank you.
I have a question. Thank you for all the questions. So, people will have their own brewery at home, or people can,
yes,
for instance, take some recipe, send it to you, and you make the beer and you send the beer.
Home brewery at home.
At home. Yeah.
At home. They can buy not only one component and to make this whole system with their hands. They can buy all system. We deliver this system to their home. It's not very expensive, as I said. And they can try themselves in this process.
And your business model will be that, for instance, you deliver ingredients or something?
Yes, we can deliver also ingredients, and we can use software for phones or something like tablet. There is a possibility to find a recipe, famous recipe. So if the company want to share it for some money paid, so and you can try and compete with it to which one will be better.
You know a company called Brewdog? It's from Scotland. They make a lot of craft beer, and they gave every recipe they have of the beer for free on the Brewdog. They want to make a very good beer.
Okay, any other questions? Yes.
How much will be the system and how much beer it can produce?
Very good question. It's a potential client.
It
I have
depends.
To say how much beer do I get back?
It depends. I think there will be a possibility to choose between some different systems for small. Maybe you want to make one bottle for you just for now, or maybe you want to make a
maybe
big barrel
for 5 or 10 or 15 liters.
Yeah.
Not really large because it will take a lot of power, electricity power. It's not for home.
Yeah, if we had more time, this is definitely an answer you should be very concrete about. And mostly they do is, we have three possibilities. If you take the student program, you invest 20 euros or dollars, and you get this, this, and this back. If you take the model, and then you have the premium model, you get, and that you really have a sort of sales strategy.
I was wondering, how does the system manage the exhaust? I mean, if you're developing some beer factories, the stench is enormous, and you don't want this at your home, so what do you do with this?
The look of love.
This question, we will think about it.
Honestly, I didn't get this question. Honestly, could you rephrase, please? Maybe I should ask.
So, when you are making the beer,
okay,
there are some exhausts which are going to the air, and
exhausts.
It smells a little. Yeah, they do really smell, and if you make it, the beer,
you're talking about ventilation system, something like that.
No,
no.
Well,
this beer.
Oh,
okay.
Then of course they do.
Ventilation system. This nice question is really smells. We know. And maybe you should.
Because they are exhausts, they are not just in the air, but rather there's this small particles, right? And they can go to the ground, and they will. And it will stay over there, and it will smell.
Okay, you drive a car?
No.
No?
No.
You drive a bicycle, and you. I don't know. You want to save your planet and so on. right?
That's not the case.
I mean that this system not very, I don't know, not so dangerous, not much more dangerous than just a car.
It's not about the danger. It's about the smell you mean.
Yeah,
it's just not about it. He doesn't like it.
Ah, your car. Okay, you can make be in your rush.
Okay.
Leave it there. Thank
Working
you.
Progress.
Let's give them a hand. Thank you, guys. Next up, almost there. Number six. Look at that opening slide. I feel like I'm in Silicon Valley already. All right. You feel ready? The best of luck.
Hello. I'm Andrew, Alex, and also was Alexander with us, but we had to run away. So we are happy to show you our project, Future Vision. And maybe some of you know this problem when you or your parents buy a new flat and it's empty. There are only big free space and you have a lot of ideas how to decorate it, what furniture to buy. You spend a lot of money, your time and your nerves to visit a lot of stocks to buy suitable furniture, and you can't see how it will be in the end. And if you are not only one, you're like a couple and you just married, buying a new flat, you spend a lot of your nerves to arguing what sofa to buy or something like that. So we give the solution. We give a solution to this problem. You all know some games like The Sims, where you can feel your designer. You just move the tall furniture across the flat and make the room of your dreams. So we want to make similar project, but using the AR and VR. So when you come to this empty room, the AR will draw your future furniture, the paint your walls, and so on. Also, if we play the some Ace Fisher, it not only it can help in not only place but by your own hands this furniture, but automatically. So, who will buy these apps? The first is new settlers who just buy a home and want to decorate their house. We give our program for them for free, because maybe no one from us buy a program which we use only one, because we were very seldom buy a new flat. The second ones, the realtors and hotels. If you want to sell the room or apartments, you want to show to your client how it looks like with furniture. It's more easy to sell a flat full of with painting walls, with sofa, chairs, tables, and so on, but not the empty flat. So when client come for you and ask what you can do with this flat, you just give them VR glasses and show how you can decorate this room. if you plan your trip, you always want to see how your future hurdles will look like from the side. Or even if you want to replace some furniture from one corner to another, you can replace it in the garage, and when you come to this hotel, the room will look like as you want. From the other side, the furniture enterprises and designers. They are our partners, because because they want to sell their furniture to the satellite, to settlers, rentals, and hotels. And if you want to promote your own furniture company, you can pay for us, and we will advise your products to the our customers. Also, there are some problems. For example, when you would like to use help of some famous designer, but you live in other country, and it will be very expensive to pay for the trip to your country. And in VR, you can connect with designers at a distance, and they help you to decorate your flat. And that's all. Questions?
Thank you. Questions?
Don't make it too easy on these guys, come on.
Will you add weather conditions, for instance? Will you add weather conditions, for instance, how the sun will go to the rooms and to the
yes, you can see this is all. Like sun goes to maybe you can go from it, see maybe like it look like at night with the light off. It's all AR and VR, so you can shut down the real image and see only image in your imagination. Build your walls in your flat and see how the sun rays goes through there.
How will you get your room inside your virtual model? Is this with a camera picture and then you put it in a model?
Yes, camera pictures. If you have some Google glasses, you just walk around your flat, the camera will. We'll record this all, also, and then our program transforms these photos into the 2D model.
You add that you can, once you make the room and you have a nice decoration, then buy.
Yes, buy you. You simultaneously see the price of this room. Also, with the help of AI, you can just put the price, and AI choose the right furniture for your room.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes.
Your idea is pretty good, but I'm sure that I have already seen the realization of it. Did you do some research of existing models and comparing?
Good question. Every investor will ask this question. Doesn't it already exist?
I see some, but they're not complex. Some of them just plant your own with camera. Another just plate your furniture. But we want to combine it, and other some power of artificial intelligence, because sometimes you have no time to decorate your flat. For example, if you're a hotel owner, you want to make a lot of unique rooms, but it costs you a lot of time. You just press make your red, blue, and classic rooms, and I made it for you.
Okay. Guys, this question reminds me of a beautiful story that is connected with you guys. Two guys who invented Google. They pitched Google to, they were PhD students, coding students, and they pitched it, they presented it, and every VC said, yeah, but it already exists. Google wasn't the first search engine. That you have to put Amazon, no, it was Ask Jeeves and Alta Vista, and they always got the same answer. Google, what you do, it already exists, it already exists. But if you build a bigger, better product, that could be your answer too, and Google wasn't the first search engine, will be the best. That is a beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
How about adding non-knowledge advertisements to your, for example, if you place a table in the room, there is also a bottle of Coke and a pair on it. For example, there is also a nice Nike sneakers can appear in your shoes shell or in some modern clothes can appear anywhere or from the press.
I think we can address this type of advertisement, but our main advertisement is advertisement of the furniture enterprises, but it not will be not so annoying, so you can choose all of them, but the first of the list was the copay class.
Okay, maybe some feedback, Sam?
No, I think it can be added value. The furniture companies and the painting companies, they have to pay you. I think the ones who are designing, whether it is the couple who has bought a new flat, or it's the designer or the architect, they don't have to pay. I think you can make money out of the furniture companies.
IKEA.
And, yeah, IKEA.
IKEA has a similar sort of app. So that's.
But you have to make it better and attractive and.
But it's only for IKEA if we unite the same companies.
Yeah. Good. Well defended too. Thank you. Did we already see the winner of today? Now? That's better. You already? Good luck.
So, here you can see our dream team. We are students of BSU, Belarusian State University. We are young minds, so we are the future. Actually, we are tomorrow's, but we forget to mention it.
Ты можешь это лечь парку просто?
So nowadays we can support ourselves with health. It's a really great problem, as I think. Medicine level is really poor, as I think, in many countries, even in Belarus. We have a healthy population. People are sick. Also, alcoholism is a problem. Sometimes we just can't get help from each other in time. Even in the street, people just pass away, and so even if you feel bad, and it's really a problem. So we decided to create a start one, save your body one. It's a I don't know how it's been. It's a series of accessories such as lenses or bracelets or maybe even glasses or everything you want. It has a good. Uh, it has software installed, so if you use it, this gadget will monitor your health, your alcohol level in your blood. Also, we have a pack of apps which can be installed, for example, on your phone, on your laptop, everything you want, such as driver controls. For example, if you're drunk, it will send a signal to your car and it will block. It will also can call a taxi. Another good thing is bar or cafe advisor. For example, it will tell you it will tell you which cocktail is good for you for now and which is not. It will monitor your likes or dislikes. So yes, and it can be integrated with the whole country, I think, because it will be used by medicine services, police services, everything you want. Just make an app and you will monitor a person, you will monitor his health, everything. Even if you want to integrate it to a country, to a government, you can even add some ID cards or credit cards and use it also. So, questions?
Yes, thank you. Questions we have here.
Yes, I have a question. Thank you for the presentation. It's good that you care about our health. But when I'm going to a bar and I'm ordering a white Russian, for example, then I don't want my phone telling me it's not good for my health.
You can ignore it, but of course you can. It's just an advisor.
Okay.
You can ignore him, it just may cause your car to be blocked for a day because you're drunk.
Okay.
Or maybe some health difficulties.
Cool thing here is that I was in Singularity University. You have to look it up. It's in Silicon Valley, the school. And the boss of Singularity University had an RFID chip implanted on the stage. And then he can open up doors and stuff like that. Just by sort of beginning of making yourself a computer. That's sort of this idea too, and there are a lot of possibilities, so great minds think alike.
It also uses non-invasive technology based on lasers.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of possibilities. I'm not sure where the money is right now. How much money do you need? What do you need to
I just can't say for now because I need to monitor market prices for producing it, technology, for prices for technology.
Yeah.
But my colleague is working on it, so.
Okay, so on the business side.
What about power? Because if you have intelligent wearables, you need power.
Yeah.
Yes, of course. So you can charge it like a USB or even
yeah.
Some maintenance stations can be used.
Yeah.
So it's just an ordinary gadget.
Question in the back.
And how I can ignore the recommendation of your device if it already blocked my car?
You can, but you know what it costs.
Well, if I'm not drunk.
If you're not drunk, it's unblocked.
So what?
It's
excuse
simple.
Me. So what if I have a friend which can drive my car?
It actually has a phone book for calling. So you can put some trusted person's numbers in this phone book, and it will send a message.
See, that is a real salesman. That's a good defense. Okay, this is a question like a judoka. I'm trying to divert it.
Good. Let's give them a hand. First
yes.
One more question, please. How can you scan alcohol level without taking the blood?
I said it's based on Ну, как твой курсач назывался?
So it's a LED laser, which scans your blood for different hormones, different for poles.
But I still need some blood.
Yeah, sweat or something else might be the solution there.
Okay, keep on going.
The spectrum of your blood will change.
Yeah, or your saliva in your mouth. Yeah.
One last question. How's that will perform if the how your application will perform if the person is aerodynamic? Will it call his mom or police?
It can call the police actually. It's a hormones. For example, if you're angry, it's a testosterone. So the spectrum of your blood will change. Laser detects. So if you're a bit dangerous, it can call the police. If your health just getting worse, so you can call the medicine service, the ambulance. So
okay, thank you. I really need to go to the toilet, so let's have a 2-minute break. The other one can set up shop, and if anyone else go to the toilet in 2 minutes, we do the last two. Okay? Thank you, guys.
Are you ready to listen?
Yes.
Hi, everyone. Our team name is at least one, and perhaps some of you may ask a question as to why this name. That's because in our beginning, it was quite difficult to generate any idea. So our thought was at least one idea, please. So and we've got it. Before we start, I want to ask one question. How many of you have a driver license here? Yes. So probably you know this problem as traffic jams. It's a problem of big cities, and it's very annoying when you want to get a job and you stay in this jam. And you're wasting your time. And how we know, the time is money and the time is our life. And I think that you don't want to spend your time in that jams. The other problem is accidents, road accidents. Our world is big and it has quite a lot of different dangers. So and the road accident is one of them. So what we have the what's the idea we have? Smart roads. We want to connect cars and roads in the general net. How does it work? So our team think that the future is by the electric cars. So we want to make chips in these cars, which will collect the information of the speed, of the direction of cars. It will help in making your ride in your car more right direction. For example, you want to get a job, go to job, and so you want to get a job, and it's quite early morning, and you don't want to drive. But you have an electric car, and it has digital intelligence. So, and it connects to our net. And our net has the status of the roads and other cars. So, it helps to in making a more right direction. So, of course, our key partners is the car companies, which produce electric cars. And also governments. And the main thing that I want to say is that our life is one, and our goal of this project is to make this life more safe.
Thanks for attention. Any questions?
Yeah, thank you. Questions for the smart roads? I think it's an interesting idea because there's a lot of energy lost when cars drive, which you can collect.
I have one question. So, do you live in Minsk maybe, or you travel by train to some other cities, towns in our country? Yes or no? It's a simple question. Have you traveled by train?
Because I don't have a car.
Okay. In future you should spread your internet connection to all, I don't know, all our earth. It's really because you can't do your project if you.
You need internet to make the.
You need internet, yes, to make the whole network of your cars, and you need internet everywhere these cars drive. So, how, in your plans, how do you want to solve these projects, these problems? You should find a lot of money to spread your internet on all these territories.
Look, good question. If you look at the Osterwald business plan, what are the resources you need to make the product work, smart roads? You need internet, you need, what do you all, and how much do you need from us to invest?
In general, you need a large base to this project.
Quite a lot.
In general, I said that you mean a real expensive base to, I don't know, to introduction your project even.
You know what?
I think that our life is more expensive than just making this project. So if the world won't have such roads and cars and chips in these cars, I think we will find the money for that.
Maybe in the future.
Of course.
Okay,
another question. Are we going to stand in traffic jams for 5 to 10 years for the works needed to make our roads smarter? Or does it require a lot of traffic work and road works, like outside here? Or can it be easily implemented? I don't know what is necessary. I don't know anything about technology. So is it only putting ships on the surface, or do we have to break up everything?
No, we don't need to break up everything because it's not quite simple, but we need chips, controllers maybe, that can recognize some marks on the road and drive through them. So we don't need to break our roads, we don't need anything on that. So if the main idea of this project that we will not control our cars, will not. The cars will be controlled through the pool net. Main server can control any car anytime. So now Tesla electric car can recognize car in front, on the sides, of course. But when it see that we can, there will be accident in front of it. It would drive on the right or to the left, and maybe program it.
It will think only about this car, and in our network, it will think about each car on the road. So
yes, a group of cars.
Yes,
yeah.
there is
the right direction.
So
for
there is
each
an advantage,
car.
But to integrate this. We have got a possibility not to do this in one time, but and to break all the roads in the city. But we can integrate it in a few steps, For example, we can do it in only one area, and other cars, they can drive in other roads, for example, not electric cars, they can use other roads, but so I don't think it will be the big difference between just to break this road and to make the new and to make our system.
Okay.
It will be more expensive.
Good that, good that you help each other. That is really the teamwork. Two things. I think it's very good that you say minimal viable product. They say that you just test it in a small piece. The other idea might be conductive paint. And that you have paint on the roads and that you have the electricity through the paint and then you don't have to break up the whole road. So two ideas still there. Thank you so much. Let's give them a hand. Love, did we see the winner or is this the winner? Last one up.
Hi guys. I'm sorry because our English is bad and we will tell in Russian, but our presentation in English, and in the end, if we have some question, if you have some question, we can ask in English.
То есть, знаете, как получается электричество в розетке? Откуда мы его берем?
Электростанция.
Какие? А какие есть электростанции?
Гидроэлектростанция.
Агрегивная. Вот, хорошо.
Ну, почти все реки. Станция это просто греют воду.
Вот, греют воду.
Какой-нибудь топливо.
И одна из основных проблем, например, ядерные электростанции или ветряк, который мы поставим где-нибудь, то, что ночью, когда большинство из производств, офисов не работают. То есть, например, ну все спят, тоже, конечно, не спит, а ходит, но это его уже проблема. Вот. Потребление электричества падает. А выключить ядерную электростанцию, типа, чуваки, все, никто не пользуется. Выключай реактор, пойдем давай спать, утро включим. Так нельзя сделать. Ну, как бы, это большие затраты, и то же самое даже с простейшей тепловой электростанции, никто не останавливает производство энергии, то есть снижают мощность или найдут на какие-то ухищрения, например, нагревают воду в котлах, и потом в часы пика, вот собственно есть график, в часы пика потом отдают вот эту энергию через двойные вот эти вот сложные преобразования снова в электрическую систему. И мы стояли около стены, смотрели вот на всякие листики. Вот. И пришла к нам идея, что вот стена, мы ее никак не используем. То есть это пространство только чисто конструкторское, как опора, как защита, как бы от окружающей среды. Но если нагрузить ее каким-нибудь функциональной нагрузкой, пусть она накапливает электричество. Вот. Чтобы потом была возможность его перераспределить. Например, отключилась ближайшая электростанция, у нас есть какие-то 5 минут, пока резерв не включится, наши стены, которые работают как конденсаторы, разрядятся, и как бы не будет вот этого вот провала. То есть мы не останемся без электричества. Вот. Почему? Сейчас вы можете спросить. Tesla, например, выпускает уже аккумуляторы, которые можно поставить у себя дома, и вы будете, ну, они заряжаются, когда электричество дешевое, то есть ночью, это реально, есть дифференцированный тариф электроэнергии, то есть ночью электричество дешевле. Вот, вы его заряжаете, ну и потом используете днем. Но это дорого, он стоит около там тысяч или двух тысяч долларов, и, а может быть даже больше, я точно так не искал, потому что времени было мало. Вот. Поэтому и использовать литий-ионные батареи или какие-то другой тип, это редкие металлы, они загрязняют окружающую среду, и поэтому идея использовать конденсатор. Как вы все знают из школьного курса, конденсатор — это две пластины проводника, между ними диэлектрик. Вот. В принципе, кирпич можно легко поместить. Две пластины, между ними может быть воздух, либо какое-то другое легко доступное вещество. Конечно, это требует дополнительных исследований. То есть мы сейчас не готовы ответить на вопрос, что скажите мне, как вот сделать из кирпича конденсатор. Это сложно. Так, это требует каких-то еще дополнительных исследований, какие материалы использовать. Может быть, не конденсатор, какой-то другой принцип. Но сама идея, вот моя была в том, что и нашей команды, в том, что использовать конденсатор. Он дешев, он прост, как бы две пластины, что сложно. Вот. И это позволит распределить нагрузку в электрические сети, сделать все равномерной, что в итоге приведет к тому, что электростанции будут работать в оптимальном своем режиме, не придется их убавлять, прибавлять мощность. Так как вы видели пик, можно график вернуть. Вот, видели пик, как бы мы должны вырабатывать по максимуму. То есть вот часы тут. Если будет меньше, то у нас, ну что, все, не будет электричества кого-то. Поэтому мы должны вырабатывать по максимуму. Если мы будем накапливать электричество, то уровень станет, например, таким. И просто в часы пика будет вот отдача от этого, а все остальное будет от конденсатора. То есть это вот наши батареи, которые будут установлены в дома. Если, в принципе, удастся сделать дешевыми и доступными, то объединить это в сети, и в сеть по городу, как бы, и вот так вот. Скажем так, оптимизироваться затраты электроэнергии. Ну вот, собственно, вся идея. Если что, есть какие-то вопросы, пытаемся на них ответить. Спасибо за
внимание. All right, thank you. Now I understand what happens to you when we start doing this. Okay, questions? You followed
everything? Everything clear? Yes? На русском? Ну,
да, не только за счет затланги. Хороший вопрос, отлично. Много проблем, связанных с инженерным внедрением этого вопроса, как такой технологии, потому что все-таки в конденсаторах есть электрическое поле, как мы все знаем. А как оно влияет на здоровье человека?
Ну, сама идея была как бы по максимуму использовать то пространство, которое просто так вот ничего не делает. Ну, стена, например, она просто несет какую-то функцию, а вот именно использовать это как накопительное.
Вот. И поэтому ответить на конкретный вопрос, как сделать защитный от влаги, такое конкретное, это требует дополнительных исследований. Мы не знаем.
То есть идея рационально использовать пространство, например, стены. Вот. Потом...
Okay.
I have a question. If you're going to use bricks as capacitors, don't you have a problem with reactive power compared to real power? And like you have Cosmos Phi, you know something about
electromagnetic.
So if you have electricity, so normally your current should follow the same as your power. If you have a alternating current, but if you have capacitors, it will be behind, or it will run before, and it's not real power, it's inductive power or capacitive power. Will this be a
technical question?
Technical question. It's about alternating current. So what you have, let me draw something. So normally, your power and your current should be in line. But if you have capacities, then your current will be not in line with your voltage. So you know this. If this happens, you have reactive power, and you have real reactive current, real current. This when you draw current. So do you know something about this, or is this completely new for everybody?
То есть потребуются какие-то устройства, которые будут переводить такой ток, который будет получать конденсаторов в нормальный
приход.
special controllers will control the basic operation.
Okay, so it's now AC to first to
see that in
that would be
okay. Any other questions? One more, last one.
In English, please. They thought about that, I know, if you place capacitors in the walls, like old walls, it will be like a Faraday cage. Because also, no radio signals will come in.
Good question.
So, cellular network, like Wi-Fi, nothing will work in this building. Do you thought about that?
Все стены можно как бы занимать конденсаторами, например, те, которые несущие стены, ну как бы это требует тоже образования.
Потолок.
Ну надо это надо исследовать, взять, сделать, попробовать сделать конденсатор и сделать эксперимент, все, что я могу сказать.
Зачем ты их
мне кажется, что достаточно конденсаторов, ну имеется в виду окна, как бы еще делать кухи, то есть подойти какой-то сделать какой-то сувенир, но
Okay, thank you. Let's give them a hand.
This is at stake. Give us 5 minutes. We will decide. You stay here.
Yes.
We will go outside and we'll be back in 5 minutes. Okay, final stage of the day. You're all winners. Do we have enough lollipops?
The last ones.
Yeah. It was great. I mean, we have had a great day working with you. I'm actually quite impressed. You were 9 teams who brought very good ideas up in a very good way. The thing that was most remarkable for all of you, that is, we saw you brainstorming this morning, it was difficult. And then you had this first idea and we came around, it was okay. And if we see now what you have been presenting, you have been thinking about it, it's much better, it's much more business-like. It's great. And the second thing, you used marvelous visuals. It was very nice to see your pictures you're using, the story you're trying to tell. It was very convincing. It was a good job for all of you, really, really. But here, for us, there was a team. There's only one winner, so there was a team who is winning.
So I'm interested to see what you think who should be the winner, and it's mostly being honest now. For us, and that is the basis of a good idea, is the first time I heard them say it in the hallway, I was like, oh! I see a million possibilities with that idea. And I see a proven business case already. What you guys have was also very interesting, and then we had the discussion, maybe they should do this, and then, okay, but is it like that? But if you have a proven business case, the investors will say, there is a big market internationally for this. So, the winners of this year, the only way is up. Give them a hand. Everyone wins the certificate of today of the business case. You can get it. You can get some lollipops. You get an extra certificate, and we would be an honor if we could take a picture with you guys.
Yeah, of course. We also want it.
Well, you have to write your own name. Because we don't know your names.
Okay, so let's have a picture, guys. Smile like you mean it. Okay, guys. Thank you.
Have a great
evening. And hopefully it's